excited about the series, primarily because I got to watch the last 3 weeks. I actually caught the first week in real time when Gerald had the backpack. Was anybody here when Gerald wore the backpack? You know, trying to talk about this idea of, I'm just going to leave this year, the baggage in our life, the stuff that weighs us down, and the stuff that really, as followers of Christ, we don't have to carry. Like, we don't have to carry it around. We don't have to be tied to it. And so over the last 3 weeks, you covered some amazing topics. Go ahead and put that up for me. The last 3 weeks, you had some amazing topics. Are they up there? This is not enough to remember it. Oh, this is the theme verse. Yeah, I'll go back to that in a minute. But the last 3 weeks, as I've kind of been studying what you guys have been talking about, I've really loved the theme of what you are free from and you don't have to carry it with you, especially the things that are really weighty. The first week you talked about anger. That was so good. Jealousy in terms of just comparison. Social media is not our friend when it comes to the comparison with one another and kind of just having that appetite rises up in us. And then last week you talked about that appetite for more, the consumeristic appetite. So if you haven't caught those messages, go back to Facebook and watch them. They're all amazing. And today we're talking about this fourth idea that Gerald had a heart to talk about, which is the freedom we have, and it's the freedom from condemnation, that feeling of being and being condemned. The theme verse, I'll just read it, you don't have to go back, is from 2 Corinthians 3:17. The Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is, what's that last word? Read it out loud.
Freedom.
Yeah, that's good. I'm having to do that a lot today, by the way, all right? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we have to understand condemnation, just to let you know, that's a kind of sometimes a spiritual word that we only sometimes use in church, but that feeling, the condemnation that comes with the feelings of guilt and shame, is something that everyone struggles with, and I'm here to tell you today that no matter where you are in your spiritual journey, you're going to deal with how to handle condemnation, with how to handle feeling guilt and shame in your life. I love that Gerald, early on, again, when we talked about this church, I love that Gerald would often say how he wanted to create a church, and again, this is the reason Lovely Norman needs to exist. He wanted to create a church where you could belong before you believe. How many have actually heard him say those words? Raise your hand if you've heard him. Yeah, he probably says it a lot, right? Yeah, that was a big deal in his heart months and months and months before you guys ever gathered as a church. He wanted a place that was safe for you to explore your questions, explore your faith, work it out in a safe environment, a safe community that you could belong to before you actually believe, before you cross a line of faith. But I will go ahead and tell you that when it comes to the theme, the topic today of condemnation, condemnation has an active work and role in our lives before we cross that line of faith. That's kind of how I put it sometimes. When you think about a spiritual journey, I just kind of make it linear. Before you cross that line of faith to follow Christ, condemnation is something you feel. You are rightfully condemned because you are separated from God by sin. That's just the reality. So the condemnation that you feel is the emptiness in your soul, that thing that can't be completed, that no relationship can fill, that no job or career can fill, that no amount of money, no amount of comfort can fill in your life. That condemnation is there for a reason. It's there to point you to God. It's there to point you for a need for a Savior. And you are rightfully condemned. The feelings you have are real, and they're there for a reason. But condemnation is also something you'll struggle with after you cross the line of faith, because it's something to help you understand what you are free from, right? It's something to help you when the feelings come up, when the temptation is there. You need to feel free to be able to say, I understand that's there. I understand the temptation to feel, to wear the guilt, to wear the shame of the consequences I'm living through. I understand that it's there, but I don't have to carry that bag if I don't want to. Why? Because I am free. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is. What's the word again?
Freedom.
Freedom. Yeah, I'm going to put it on the screen if you don't remember. Okay, there's freedom. That's the role of condemnation that it plays in our life. Problem is that for most Christians, I'm going to have you raise your hand. This is a raise your hand moment, okay? How many of you personally, or you just know that this has been your life with Christians in your life, that they wear condemnation, they wear the guilt of past decisions, they wear the guilt of mistakes they've made. They wear the shame of consequences they have to live through. Because, sin has consequences regardless of whether you're a follower or not. And they wear the shame of consequences, and their life honestly doesn't look that different than anyone else. Just raise your hand if you know someone like that, you've seen that experience. And then why is that? I mean, if we're stating from a fact place that we are free, we don't have to carry that bag, why do people choose to carry it? That's what we're going to talk about today. I want to talk about, you'll hear me use the word religion a lot today, and when I say the word religion, I am going to be talking about it in a negative context, all right? The reason that many people live and feel, even after they cross the line of faith as a follower of Christ, the reason they live with guilt and shame is because they have bought into that is what religion looks like. That there's an element of some churches and some teaching and some assumptions of religion, but that's just how it works. That God wants me to feel bad about my sin so that I'll live a better life. And I call this, just so you know, I call this the gold star. Let's see if my slides up there. I call this the gold star religion. All right? How many got gold stars when you were a kid in school? Just raise your hand if you're someone like me. You got gold stars, right? That's the gold star religion. It's the idea that God is sort of watching your life and sort of, you know, assessing every moment and every thought and every decision and every action and deciding how you respond to things and the decisions you make and the words you use. And when you do something good, he gives you what?
Gold star.
He gives you a gold star. And we live this sort of religion where that's the life. We get gold stars for not only behaving good, but not behaving badly, right? We get gold stars for not doing the thing we're attempted to do, to not watch what we shouldn't watch and say what I wanted to say in traffic, even though no one else could hear me but God, right? That's gold star religion. And the problem with gold star religion is that when you believe that God rewards your behavior, when you believe that God slaps a gold star when you do something good or you choose not to do something bad, you have no choice but to believe that he passes out demerits. You have no choice but to believe that when you do mess up, when you do sin, when you do allow that thought to come into an action in your life, you have no choice but to believe that God at that point is now passing judgment and guilt on you, and he wants you to feel it. That's the demerit side of that religion. And it's probably the worst thing that could happen to Christianity, is for us to fall into the religious trap that God passes out gold stars for good behavior, and he gives you demerits when you blow it. And the reality is that's how a lot of Christians, whether or not it's taught, whether or not it's actually taught in church, whether or not it's actually spoken, whether or not they've actually read it in the Bible, they just assume that about God. That that's how he functions. That's how he, it's really the definition, if you will, of religion. And so, today I want to read a little bit of what Paul wrote. A lot of Paul's letters in the New Testament, just like 2 Corinthians we just read, a lot of Paul's letters in the New Testament all have foundational teaching in it. And all of them are going to talk about the freedom we have in Christ. They're going to talk about our freedom from fear, our freedom from condemnation, our freedom from guilt, our freedom from shame, our freedom from sin. And he does that on purpose. He does that to help us understand foundationally the human condition. And then help us understand the gospel, which is what did Christ do. And so we're going to look at some of Paul's writings in the New Testament to help us understand why it is that it's not just a good idea that you and I can leave the baggage behind that weighs us down in our life of guilt and shame and feeling condemned if we are a follower of Christ. Why we can actually do that and why it is he wants us and needs us to do that so that we can be a light to the world, so that we can be used by him to share the freedom of Christ with others. And so this is in Romans. We're going to look at Romans 7 and Romans 8. In Romans 7, Romans is an amazing book of the Bible to read. My church is actually going through it right now. But Romans 7 kind of comes after he's talked about sin and grace, and he's giving some collections of thoughts in 6, 7, and 8. He gets to 7 and actually says this, because he's talking about the human condition. He says, I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what's right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. Raise your hand if you can relate to that statement at all, right? Most of the time, it's with food with me. That's my problem. I really understand what I want to do, but I don't do it. I do this instead. And he says, look, this is the human condition. He goes on to talk about this is sin in me. This is a reality of my life. And then towards the end, he actually just states it. Oh, what a miserable, right? Go to that next verse. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that's dominated by sin and death? Thank God, the answer is Jesus Christ. And then he gives this summary statement of the last couple chapters. And here it is. He says, you see how it is. In my mind, I really want to obey God's law. In my mind, I really want to do what's right. But because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin. Now, the period is there because it ends the thought, it ends the chapter. It doesn't end the complete thought, obviously, of Romans. It doesn't end the message Paul is saying. However, if you are not a follower of Christ, and again, you're free to not be, you're free to belong before you believe, but I want you to know that if you have not crossed the line of faith and made that decision, that this is where your story ends. That there is an aspect of your life that you can say, I can totally agree with that, I understand that, but it ends here. You have no choice but to feel the condemnation of that statement. But it's supposed to draw you into chapter 8. It's supposed to draw you to where he calls the followers of Christ. And he goes on to say, even the words you guys use here about belonging, you go into chapter 8, and it says, so now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. Go to the next verse. It says, the law of Moses was unable to save us. And he's talking to the fellow Jewish people who'd be reading this letter. He said, the law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. Right? Religion itself, the religious game of gold stars and demerits, it plays into our broken nature. It's why we can't save ourselves. It's why we could never be good enough. It's why the law itself couldn't do it. And he goes on to say, so God did, right? What the law could not do. He sent his own son into the body of the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared the end to sin's control over us by giving his son a sacrifice for our sins. That's the gospel message. Paul wants you to see not just the human condition, not just where we all live, but where you are actually allowed to go when you cross that line of faith and you belong to Christ. When you belong to him, there is no condemnation to those who belong to Christ. Because of not anything you did, because of what he did for you. And then later on, at the very end of chapter 8, or at the end, actually this is towards the last part of chapter 8, he actually completes the thought of now the relationship that's changed. Here's the changing of the guard, if you will. Go to verse 15. It says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. You did not receive a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. He goes on to say, look, remember what I talked about before about the human condition? You have no choice but to be a slave to sin. He says, look, when you're a child of God, you did not receive that spirit. It goes on to verse 16. It says, instead, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. And now we call him Abba Father. For his Spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we're God's children. And so, getting our minds out of the religious practice, out of the religion, thoughts, the gold stars and the demerits and the having to prove myself and make myself right, getting out of that and understanding the freedom we have to put that bag down, to put the weight down and run the race, live the life that God's called us to live, we have to understand the new relationship we have. And so here's the relationship change. The relationship change goes from, go for it. It goes from our relationship with sin. It's master-slave. There's a master involved and there is a slave involved. And just to be honest with you guys, you may think you're the master, but you are actually the slave. And that is the relationship we have. That is the human condition, period. And we have no choice, again, but to feel of the condemnation in our lives that separates us from God. But our relationship with God is father to child. And that's freedom. Our relationship with God is now moved into father to child. And maybe you struggle to see that relationship. Maybe you yourself really struggle with the manifestation of that because you didn't have a good relationship with your father. You haven't seen that play itself out in father figures. You didn't see that play itself out in authority. You've not seen this play itself out in a way that actually redeems and gives you hope. But you have to remember that God is not the reflection of our earthly fathers. He's the perfection of an earthly father. Does that make sense? He's the the perfection of it. And so just like when Jesus describes God in Luke 15 as the father of two sons, and he says, you know, one son decided he wanted to take his money, take his inheritance, and go and leave and reject the family and reject his father. And he leaves and goes and, you know, just spends it all, and not just, you know, the guilt and shame of sin, but he actually ends up in the filth, you know, in terms of Jewish culture, the filth and the worst possible place he could be when he comes to his senses. And when he returns home, the picture of the prodigal son, which is actually the prodigal father, the picture of the father is that he's looking from a distance. When he sees the son turn to come home, he runs to meet him, arms wide open, no condemnation, no fear. You know, no sort of doling out forgiveness as he now proves himself back to the father. No religious gold stars or demerits from the dad. He's fully free to become his son. Puts the shoes on his feet, the robe on his body, and the ring on his finger, all signifying amazing things. And he goes on to say, you know, the dad's he just says, look, guys, we have to celebrate because my son who was lost is now found. One who is dead is now alive. That's the picture of the perfection of our Heavenly Father. And that is the relationship you get to have. So this is why you don't need to carry the condemnation. This is why you don't need to carry the guilt and shame in your life. But we all struggle with it. And Paul knew we would. Matter of fact, we're going to go read a letter that he wrote to the church in Galatia. This is one of my favorite passages of Scripture. I use this a lot. When I say a lot, you know, it's very much like Gerald saying, you can belong before you believe. I probably say this set of Scriptures just as much as he says that. Okay, this is a big Scripture for me. And this is where Paul, again, as he ends this letter to Galatia, he does all the teaching in the early part to the church of Galatia about the truth about who God is and the freedom you have and the relationship you have. He says these words in Galatians 5. He says, so Christ has truly set you free. Right? Set us free. Now make sure that you, what's the two words there? Say it out loud. That you stay free and don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. All right? If there are two words that I want you to remember today, it's those two words. Say them again one more time.
Stay free.
Say it like it's in the Word of God. You ready? One more time. Say
stay free.
That's all I want you to remember. Because as a follower of Christ, that's your role. It says in NIV, he says it's for freedom that he set you free. So it's for freedom. Like, the goal is for you to be free. So it's for freedom that he set you free. But now here's what we have to do. We have to, say it again.
Stay free.
But to stay free. Well, that shouldn't be that hard. And here he goes to explain. A little bit later, you're going to go to verse 6 and 7. But he goes on to explain some of the things that were happening in that church culture as to why they weren't free. He goes on to say this. I think it's verse 7. Yeah, he says, you are running the race so well. This is Paul, you know, kind of a backwards encouragement. He's like, you are doing so great. Who held you back? Who weighed you down? Why are you carrying this bag? You don't need to carry it from following the truth. It certainly isn't God. Why? Because he's the one who called you to freedom. It's not God. Okay, so let me just put this out there. I have a lot of conversations. Because I'm a pastor, I have a lot of conversations with people in the office, and understand this. Just understand, I'm going to share with you, I'm going to be vulnerable. I am not a good counselor, okay? I'm just not. And pastors need to know who they are. Okay, that's just the way it is. So I sit with people to counsel, and they only usually meet with me once. Number one, because I know that if they met with me more, I screw them up worse than they were before. And I also know that I lack some of the compassion sometimes to really kind of speak into the, you know, good counselors, man, they can go the long haul and listen and have compassion and empathy. I lack a lot of those things, right? I should have sent everybody to Gerald. Gerald's got all of those things, and, you know, more than me. But I bring this verse up a lot because it's not to belittle the problems that we have, but when someone starts sharing with me the struggles that they're having, the struggles with faith, the struggles they're having in following God, the thoughts they're still having, the actions they're still doing, the behavior they still find themselves in, and they start talking about the way they feel, and they start to lean in a direction where they actually are blaming God. God makes them feel that way. And I have to come to this set of verses, and I'm like, yeah, but let me just say this. If it's for freedom, if he's truly set you free, then you need to stay free. Meaning that if you don't feel free as a follower of Christ, you're doing it wrong. You guys with me? If you're not free, then I don't know what you signed up with. You're in a gold star religion. If you're not more free than you were before, then I don't know who you're following. Because God, for freedom, he set you free. And then he goes on, he sets you on a race. He sets you in the course of your life to live as a witness for him, to live out the truth of the freedom that he's given you. And he goes on to say, Paul says, hey, who stopped you? What's the weight that's holding you back? Why are you holding on to this guilt and shame? It's not God's fault. It's yours. It's your fault. It's your fault that you believe he wants you to feel bad about the sin in your life. That's on you. That's not on him. It's for freedom he sets you free. And once we understand this, once we really get to the goal of understanding, okay, wait a minute. Matt, I still have these thoughts. I still have the bad thoughts. I still am tempted to do the thing I shouldn't do. I still occasionally do the things I shouldn't do, as Paul says in Romans 7. And he goes on to say, yeah, but understand, people have used this word in terms of the conviction of God, the conviction of the Spirit. But understand, there is a massive difference between conviction and condemnation. The conviction of the Holy Spirit is more like cracking a shell open so that you can be free. It's more like breaking apart the excuses we've made and breaking apart the walls we've built so that we can be lifted up, so that we can be free, because it's for freedom that he set me free. All condemnation does is want to tear you down. All condemnation does, in terms of even that visual that Gerald used with the backpack, all condemnation wants to do is pass out that guilt and pass out that shame and make you wear it and wear you down so you cannot run the race he's called you to run. That's it. And when you begin to really understand that it's for freedom he set me free, that when he has truly set you free, then yeah, you're going to have struggle times. You're going to still struggle with running this race and tripping and falling and making mistakes and having sin come in and having sin win every once in a while in your life. But you need to remember these words, that Christ is not the one who's making you feel bad about that. He's not the one trying to drag you down. It's for freedom. He's the one who called you to. And when you have that, guys, you can leave the bag. You can just leave it there. You can just, I don't want to say that it's like easy, because I know I say it easy, but I know it's difficult to put it down and leave it. But I'm telling you, that's what you as a follower of Christ have the freedom to do. You do not have to live with the guilt of the thoughts that enter your mind. The thoughts that come, you do not live with the shame of consequences that you're currently living because of sin in your life. We have a phrase in our church that we use all the time that says, look, there's absolutely nothing that can make God love you any more than he already does. We make that statement so that we can kill gold star religion. There's nothing you can do. Doesn't that make you feel free? Nod your head if you feel a little more free about that statement. Now, the follow-up to that statement is, there is nothing you have done that makes him love you any less. There's nothing you can do to make him love you more. Stop striving. There's also nothing you have done that makes him love you any less. And when you arrive there, you begin to understand, Galatians 5, you begin to understand that it was for freedom that he did, the work on the cross was to set me free. My job, our job, is to say the two words again.
Stay free.
That's our job, is to stay free. I want to read as we close out, before I give you the final verse, I want to read this poem. And I'll be honest with you, I'm not a poem guy. Maybe you guys are poem people, but I'm not a poem guy. But this particular poem I read about 5 years ago. And it was so powerful in my life. It was such a moving time for me to take what we've read and the challenge we have in terms of the race of our life and to help me. So this is actually written from the first person context, and I'll be honest, I could read this, if I could quote it by memory, I could read it as if it's my story. But I want to read this poem and then give you the closing passage today as we leave. And here's where the poem starts. Quit, give up your beat. They shout and plead. There's too much against you now. This time you can't succeed. And as I start to hang my head in front of failure's face, my downward fall is broken by the memory of a race. They all lined up so full of hope, each thought to win the race or tie for first, or if not that, at least take second place. And fathers watched from off the side, each cheering for their son, and each boy hoped to show his dad that he would be the one. The whistle blew and off they went, young hearts and hopes of fire. To win, to be the hero there was each boy's desire. And one boy in particular, his dad in the crowd, was running near the lead and thought, my dad will be so proud. But as he speeded down the field across a shallow dip, the little boy who thought to win lost his step and slipped. Trying hard to catch himself, his hands flew out to brace, and amid the laughter of the crowd, he fell flat on his face. So down he fell, and with him hope. He couldn't win it now, embarrassed, sad, he only wished to disappear somehow. But as he fell, his dad stood up and showed his anxious face, which to the boy so clearly said, get up and win the race. He quickly rose, no damage done, behind a bit, that's all, and he ran with all his might to make up for his fall. So anxious to restore himself, to catch up and to win, his mind went faster than his legs. He slipped. Fell again. He wished that he had quit before with only one disgrace. I'm hopeless as a runner now. I shouldn't try to race. But in the laughing crowd, he searched and found his father's face. That steady look again said, get up and win the race. So he jumped up to try again, 10 yards behind the last. If I'm to gain those yards, he thought, I've got to run real fast. Exceeding everything he had, he regained 8 or 10. But trying so hard to catch the lead, he slipped and fell again. Defeat. He lay there silently and a tear dropped from his eye. There's no sense in running anymore. 3 strikes and I'm out. Why try? The will to rise had disappeared and all hope had flew away. So far behind, so error-prone, and closer all the way. I've lost, so what's the use, he thought. I'll live with my disgrace. And then he thought about his dad, who'd soon he have to face. Get up, an echo sounded low. Get up and take your place. You were not meant for failure here. Get up and win the race. With borrowed will, get up, it said. You haven't lost it all, for winning is not more than this, to rise each time you fall. So he rose up to win once again. And with a new commit, he resolved to win or lose. At least he wouldn't. So far behind the others now, the most he'd ever been, still he gave it all that he had and ran as though to win. 3 times he had fallen and stumbling, 3 times he rose again, too far behind with a hope to win, he still ran to the end. They cheered the winning runner as he crossed first place, head high and proud, happy, no falling, no disgrace. And when the fallen youngster crossed the line, last place, the crowd gave him the greater cheer for finishing the race. And even though he came in last with head bowed low, unproud, you would have thought he'd won the race to listen to the crowd. And to his dad, he sadly said, I didn't do so well. To me, you won, the father said. You rose each time you fell. And when things seem dark and hard and difficult to face, the memory of that little boy helps me win. my race. For all of life is like that race, with ups and downs and all. And all you have to do to win is rise each time you fall. Quit. Give up. You're beaten. They still shout in my face, but now another voice within me says, get up and win the race. Hebrews 12:1. Language that Paul uses quite often. He says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every, what's the word?
Weight.
That slows us down. Especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. Well, how do we do it? How do we do it? We do this by keeping our eyes on who?
Jesus.
The champion who initiates. He began. He started it. He initiated this. The champion who initiates and perfects our faith. My challenge to you this morning, in all of this series, to leave it there, to leave behind what you do not need to carry, is to understand that you've been called to run the race that God has for your life. Guys, you can't do it if you are dragging behind and being weighed down by the feelings of condemnation. It is for freedom that He set you free. You have to stay free. You have to remember that it wasn't Him. It's not Him holding you back. It's not Him that's doing this. He's the one who's called you to freedom. Let's pray together this morning. Father God, my hope and prayer this morning is that for those of us in the room, God, who are followers of you, God, that you would encourage us this morning, that you would breathe into our hearts hope, that you would help us understand that, yes, we far too often have allowed the tripping and the falling of our race weigh us down with guilt and shame and give us baggage that you never called us to carry. That regardless of how people have twisted Scripture, how people have assumed on God the demerits and you, God, the gold stars, that God, that is not true, that is not your gospel. I think, God, you love us with an unfailing love and we are free from the sin of our lives, the power that it holds. And so we in this room, God, we can when the thoughts come in, when the temptations come, regardless of our choices, God, you call us to give us the power to choose you. But God, when we don't choose you, you give us the freedom through your conviction to be free from that weight. God, your freedom does not eradicate sin from our hearts and lives. It just frees us from the power. Thank you, Jesus, that we didn't deserve, that we didn't earn. God, thank you for this race we've been called to run. And God, I pray for anyone here today who has yet to cross that line, who has yet to move from a place of investigating, from a place of just thinking about and wondering and trying to resolve some of the things they have heard about you and felt about you, God, that today they would make the choice to become a follower of you. I'll just pray this morning with you, if that's where you are here. Again, you have, as Gerald often says, you have full freedom to belong to this community and continue to work out the questions you have. But if this morning, if you want the freedom that He's given His followers, His children, if you want to change the relationship you have with sin, which is a master-slave relationship, and you want to move into a place where you have the relationship of a father and his child, I want you just to raise your hand where you are this morning. Just raise your hand. And I want to pray a prayer that you guys can pray with me, okay? Just pray this prayer with me. Father God, I accept the gift of your son, the sacrifice he paid for me. Father God, I can't do it on my own. My nature, my relationship to sin is where I am nothing but a slave. God, I want the freedom that you give those who call on your name, who confess with their mouth that you are Lord. I want to move into this relationship with you as a heavenly Father who loves his child, who frees us from sin. God, I just give you my life right now. And I encourage you to pray that prayer this morning, to follow up with some of the staff here, follow up with those in this church that would love to just walk this race and this life, this journey with you. Please don't let this just pass you by. Engage someone today. Father God, give us the strength, all of us in here, as we take communion this morning, as we come to remember what you have done for us, give us the strength this morning to lay down our feelings of condemnation. All the more worshiping, all the more praising how good you are, all the more lifting up of our souls, how amazing you are to give us.